is freezing, an extraordinary minus 18 degrees Celsius, and it's snowing, and in the language which is no longer mine, the snow is canic, big, almost weightless crystals falling in stacks, and covering the ground with a layer of pulverized white frost. December darkness rises up from the grave, seeming as limitless as the sky above us. In this darkness, our faces are merely pale, shining discs. But even so, I can sense the disapproval of the pastor and the verger directed at my black knit stockings and at Julianne's whimpering, made worse by the fact that she took disulfiram this morning and is now confronting her grief almost sober. They think that she and I have no respect for either the weather or the tragic circumstances. The truth is that both the stockings and the pills, each in their own way, are a tribute to the cold and to Isaiah. The women's sounds surrounding Julianne and the pastor and the verger are all Greenlanders, and when we sing Gudiga Ilimi, Thou my Lord, and as Julianne's legs buckle under her and she begins weeping, the volume slowly increasing, and when the pastor speaks in West Greenlandic, taking his point of departure in the Moravian's favourite passage from St. Paul about redemptions through the blood, then with only a tiny lapse of concentration one might feel oneself transported to Upernavik, or Holsteinsborg, or Karnak. But out in the darkness, like the bow of a ship, looms the walls of Vestra Prison. We are in Copenhagen. Greenlander Cemetery is part of Vestra Cemetery. With Isaiah in his coffin has come a procession consisting of those of Julianne's friends who are now holding her upright, the pastor and the verger, the mechanic, and a small group of Danes, among whom I recognise only the probation officer and the guardian. The pastor is now saying something that makes me think he must have never actually met Isaiah, even though, as far as I know, Julianne has never gone to church. Later, his voice disappears, because now the other women are weeping along with Julianne. Many have come, perhaps 20, and now they let their sorrow wash through them like a black flood, into which they dive and let themselves be carried along in a way that no outsider could understand. Is not grown up in Greenland. And even that might not be enough, because I can't follow them either. For the first time, I look closely at the coffin. It's hexagonal. At a certain point, ice crystals take the same form. Now they are lowering him into the ground. The coffin is made of dark wood. It looks so small. Snow on it. The flakes are no bigger than tiny feathers. And that's the way snow is. It's not necessarily cold. What is happening at this moment is that the heavens are weeping for Isaiah, and the tears are turning into down of frost that is covering him up. In this way, the universe is pulling an eiderdown over him, so that he will never again feel the cold. Moment the pastor throws earth on the coffin, and we are supposed to turn around and leave, a silence falls which seems to last for a long time. In this silence the women are quiet, no one moves. It's like a silence which is waiting for something to break. From where I am standing, two things happen. First, Julianne falls to her knees and puts her face to the ground, and the women leave her alone. The second event is internal, inside me, and what breaks is an